for the four P's: people, planet, purpose and profit. I'm Swanette and I'm your host. Welcome to my podcast, Holistic Creators. My name is Swanette and I'm your host. Today, my guest is Erika Maisi from erikamaisi.me. Welcome to my podcast.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Swanette, for the introduction and for having me here. Yeah. Sharing this space together. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we already had a little bit of conversation before, and I'm totally curious to hear about what happened in your life, where you come from. You said that you come from Kazakhstan, but you feel that your roots are still there somehow, but you now live abroad. And can you tell me a little bit about your journey, what have been important steps you made, and what have been experiences that help you to be the person that you are now at this time?
Yeah, so where do I start? Yes, I definitely start where I was born. It's in Almaty, Kazakhstan. I lived there the first 9 years of my life. Before then, my family all moved to Germany. And I have not been back to my roots for over 30 years until the year 2017, right immediately after I started embroidering of this towel. It's called Destiny Towel, a very, very old Slavic tradition. It's a rushnik. And this particular one is a Destiny Towel. It's actually divided like a tree in the three worlds. It's the ancestral world, the middle world, and the divine world. And I attended a workshop on the island of Rügen in 2017 with a Russian embroidery master. And something it's never left me. And I started to remember, and I started to follow my calling. It's like, what is this like call like around my roots, where I felt always disconnected after we moved from Kazakhstan to live here? And it was always this big question, where are my roots? I don't belong anywhere. And I felt most of my life very very depressed and alienated, not having those roots. And once I started to pick up the thread and learning more to connect with the sacred symbols, to the divine source, I started to perceive myself more and more as a conscious destiny weaver. And listening very closely to the signs and messages calling me out. And so just 2 months afterwards, after attending the workshop, I heard the call to go back to my roots. So I did a crowdfunding campaign, and I traveled almost 2 months with the Trans-Siberian Railway through all Russia, then Kazakhstan. After 30 years, I reconnected with my family from my mother's side. They are all still living there, and Mongolia. And always also with this like impulse within me to learn more about these different cultures of embroidery, which all tell a different story, all these different cultural backgrounds got their own way of expression through embroidery. So I visited a lot of ethnographic museums, and I started to compile like a database of different symbols. And I actually written a book about it, which I published this year on the magical day of my birthday, is the 4th of the 4th. And as it happens, 2020, the year when added together is also 4. So much about the magic of numbers. I published this book. It's called The Weirding Way. And weirding means weaving. And on the front page, those are the three Norns in the Norse mythology. And they're holding the timelines of the past, present, and future. So this is all a deepening practice. Telling my own story from, like I say, from weird to weirding, like weird, always feeling uprooted, disillusioned, until I started to pick up the thread And I reconnected with my ancestors, and then the practice deepened. I have embroidered my destiny dress with certain goddess energies which support me through life. And then even the three norns, which are said to weave like the whole web of life, are now weaving through me. And all what I'm doing is like surrender more and more to these transmissions I receive, which I then manifest in terms of embroidery. And I call it a sacred embroidery because it's not just for the means of beauty, it's really being connected deeply to this divine source which is weaving through me, through all of us. And yeah, it's about like from weird to weirding, from separateness to weirding, which is conscious weaving of our destiny and the tapestry of the whole life. So just very briefly.
Yeah, I would like to know a little bit more about how it felt for you when you left Kazakhstan when you have been 9 years old. So you have been in your own culture, in your own tradition. And then you said, yeah, it was like I lost my root when I came to Germany. Can you explain a little bit what was the change and how did you feel about that?
Well, first of all, I didn't understand as a girl why we left, because all of a sudden the luggage was packed and we just meant to leave. And I was a very happy child. I was actually very talented in tennis. I played tennis in a boarding school. So this was my whole life. And I was a very confident, energetic child. And then all of a sudden the bags were packed and we left. I didn't speak the language. And it was very difficult for me because here it was the total opposite world. It was communist in Kazakhstan back then. When I arrived here, I continued to be sponsored in tennis and being presented as this highly talented kid. But here it was a very competitive sport. So I started to be mobbed very badly and I was not able to defend myself and everything. So for me, the move was very, very harsh. And then it didn't take long. I became a teenager, so it was very difficult for me to reconcile. All of a sudden, going from a very happy child to a very mobbed and very quiet. Like I started to turn more and more within myself, and I even had suicidal attempts when I was 14 years old. And it started to continue like that. I was always very unhappy and had to do with this, like being like, it's like a tree being taken out and put somewhere else. It continued like that until 2017, or like I introduced it earlier, when I consciously started to connect, with my ancestry roots, with this question, where am I from and who am I really, beyond this feeling of not having a particular culture where I'm from? Because here I'm always a foreigner. If I speak with Russian people, I'm also a foreigner because I don't speak Russian fluently with a great accent. So I only knew this feeling of being disconnected and not belonging anywhere. So throughout my whole life until 2017.
So these are many years you didn't really felt connected to one culture or the other, and it was like kind of struggling and searching, as I understand it. And only then 2017, as you went back going back to Russia and Kazakhstan, you had this feeling, okay, now if something opens up and I feel that there is something in my ancestral line also that can help me to understand what will be my future. Is it like this?
Yes, it was like, I read the books, Anastasia books. I don't know if people know them, by Vladimir Mikre. There is a big movement actually around the world already, started from Russia, where there are many people living now in this what they call kin domains, inspired by those books. And one of those books, they describe this ritual of women wearing those dresses where every symbol has got a meaning, and old textiles are embroidered with symbolism. So also this book started, like, it didn't leave me alone. So that's, I describe it as the metaphor of picking up my unique thread. There was something calling me. And all what I did is continue to search, like, and why is this calling me? That's why I attended the seminar about the embroidery. And I started to read about shamanism, which was calling to me again and again from after I read this book by Olga Karadzic, Entering the Circle, where this shaman Umay from Siberian background came to me. And there was my dad, who was brought up in Siberia, but I never had any connection with this culture. But what happened to me is, like, I started to hear those voices, like, or those nudges, like, go and search and start to do embroidery. And it, for me, it's really like I picked up the thread, and whilst I started to embroider, my memories came back. And I started to speak with my dad. I started to organize this trip. And on the trip, by meeting the people, I met a lot of shamans and also embroidered with indigenous women from this different cultural backgrounds. And it was step by step or stitch by stitch. It's like a remembering where I come from. And manifested in textiles. And it's like coming back and back more and more within myself to my own roots, that there is like this divine power expressing itself through me, that the roots are within me. And it's like this Rusnik, that's why it's so sacred. It's like a life tree. And once we become more and more conscious about what gives us roots within ourselves, what gives this stability, the trunk, to be centered in this physical world, what we came here for, and the connection to the divine, it's like coming home within myself and no longer having to search on the outside. Yeah, so it's a sacred journey back to myself through the practice of embroidery.
Yeah, well, you just said there was a voice speaking to you. So do you feel that you are very intuitive, or do you use other senses? What can you explain a little bit about that?
Yes, I was actually always very intuitive from being a little girl, like clairvoyant, as they say. I was always seeing angels, Christ, and fairies and everything. But obviously, since I moved into Germany, it was all cut off, and now it came more and more back, because what I learned from a Russian master, embroidery master, is like you always meditate before you embroider. And I also learned which seven goddesses, which are called Berejinis in Russian, are always there by my side, and they are embroidered in my destiny dress, which is also like a tree. There are the three goddesses standing for the roots, then my main goddess energy, which is the raven, and then three goddesses, which are like branches. If I lift up the sleeve, then they are like, yeah, the branches going up. This is like to fulfill my potential. And there are ways to connect with those goddesses. Like every day I do certain movements, there are affirmations. I also work very intimately with the runes and chanting of the runes. And this is a form of divination. We connect with those energy, with those goddesses, by the means of movements, chanting, and then they are very present. It's like one of my goddesses, for example, is the muse. I did a ritual every single day when I was writing the book to connect with the muse. I would invite her in, I would put on my dress, I would put on the candle, the music, and create a sacred space. And the muse is then very present. It's like something is writing through me. And it's the same like with embroidery. If I do this ritual, it's like something is being woven through me. And yeah, it is like a divination practice in that sense. And I do receive messages, of course, in symbols, in certain like instincts and impulses, and And the more we make space for that, the more it becomes apparent. Like I also feel it in the body, like a certain sensation. This is a yes or no, and it becomes a very alive thing.
Well, very amazing to hear that. And I'm curious to hear a little bit more about the three goddesses. So you said it is one of the past, one of the present, and one of the future. And you wrote about that in your book. Can you tell a little bit more about the insight you got and what you wrote in your book?
Yes, like there's a reason why it's called the Weirding Way, because the weird has got many different meanings in the Nordic language and mythologies. Weird is first of all like the rune. There's a rune called weird that is nothingness. It's the void where at the same time everything arises from. So you can also say that the weird, I always connect with the weird through chanting. It's like we can place ourselves in this void, which is the womb of all existence, where everything, all possibilities arise from. So if we chant the rune weird, we can easily get into this space of all possibilities. And then weirding, that's what the Norns are doing, who sit by the root of the world tree Yggdrasil and weave the timelines. This is also weirding, which is conscious creation from the space of nothingness. If you conscious connected to the weird, then by means of your thoughts, you can create the physical realm. And then we can also travel through the timelines from this point of no existence. The physicists call it the zero point. For example, yeah, and if we know how to access it, for me it came through the weird, then we can do timelines travelings, we can do ancestral healing, we can do anything, because from the weird there is no time and space. Yeah, and this is the weaving, conscious weaving of destiny, just like the Norns are doing, who are holding the timelines of the past, present and future. And my book is called The Weirding Way, the mysterious art of weaving your own destiny. Because if you consciously know how to tap into this field or the womb of all existence, and you start to weave like the Norns are doing, it becomes a life's practice. Like for me, this is a life's practice, an ongoing practice unfolding. Because as long as we live, it's like our secret destiny, which is connected to the web of weird, it's always unfolding. It's an unfolding experience. It's not finished. So okay. It's like, yeah.
Well, what I understand, it is like an ongoing process. But can you give me an example or audience an example to make it a little bit more clear how this could look like?
Yeah, for example, when I do my rune reading, so before I start the embroidery practice, I also do like the mudra like this, which connects us to all timelines and dimensions of the universe. I always put it in front of the womb. And then I chant weird, for example, for 5 to 10 minutes, but you can also do it a few times and set your intention in this space of the weird. And that's how you invite, yeah, the energies to come into this physical realm where you're present. So that is one way. Or there's also the hool breath, which I learned from a shaman from like the Nordic tradition. And hool breath, it's like the German speaking people, we know that hool sounds like Höhle. And old people from the past have been gathering in caves, which is Höhle in Germany. And they've been chanting this sound like hool. And it is also, if you do it a few times, you can hear it's like a combination of three runes. Hagelash, Laguz and Urush. And if you also imagine when you chant Hul, Hagelash is the snowflake, it comes from above, then it dissolves, and Lagus is the water, then it goes down to the Urush, which are our roots. So once again, to the sound, we are then connected to our life force energy, which goes up and down. It's like the breath in and out breath. And in that way, we can also learn how to get a feeling for the circulation of life force energy and how we are all interconnected with everything around us. So this is also very, very powerful breathing exercise. And our breath is actually the key which connects us to the physical and to the divine, because who are we really? We are not just the bodies. We are being breathed in every moment. And this is the key. And the more we take space to be conscious about what is breathing us, the more we become the co-creators. So those are very easy and very effective ways to connect to the weird or to God, goddess, to the deities around us. I mean, different people have got different ways to express what is around us.
So can everybody learn this, or does someone need special abilities or special mindset to go into these techniques and to use it for themselves?
Everybody can learn it. There's a certain chanting and breathing exercises, so everybody can learn it. And I also learned, for example, to the particular goddesses which are by my side and weaving through me. I learned also from two Russian women, and there's a free ebook I can give to people. I translated it from German into English, and on the website we can also discover our main Beregini, for example, which is always by our side. For me, it's the raven. And there is a symbol and an affirmation, and there are certain movements which are very practical. You can paint, you can embroider, like I did. I embroidered all the symbols, especially the ones which are by my side, because it brings me much closer to this, to those energies. But I think those are also very practical examples to connect with the symbols, to the messages which the goddesses bring to us. And I also offer workshops where a woman can, for example, meet her own, like Matryoshka goddess, and start to listen what kind of symbols she brings to the woman, and the symbolism and the message which she carries then inside. And this is a very easy exercise, but it's a start to connect with those energies which are always there and waiting for us to get in contact with them. And the magic happens once we do start, and then like, oh wow, I never thought that before. It's like, oh, this symbol means that. This is telling me that. And it's like, oh wow. And that's the magic then, which starts to happen in the everyday life.
Asking you a bit about the symbols. So are these symbols the same for everyone? Like there's one symbol having one meaning, or is it more like when we start going into our intuition and we see these symbols, that they do have only a special meaning for us individually? So how is it? Like all symbols are the same, have the same meaning, or is it more like we have the personal ones or individual ones?
I think both is true. I mean, I started to compile like with the 27 goddess symbols from the Slavic traditional backgrounds. On my travels, I learned different symbolism, and they're actually different from each culture. I mean, some of like for the sun or the moon or the life tree, they do have some resemblance, but at the same time, what interests me, and I'm dreaming to go always deeper into things, to maybe do a PhD around it, to set up a database for all those different symbols around the world, because it's like a secret language of us women, because we as women, we're not allowed to write books, or to read books. So, but we were always doing something with our hands and with textiles. So it's like a long forgotten language, which I like to revive. And it's very interesting. So I made a start with the symbols I learned so far. But in the workshops I've been giving so far, it's also interesting the own symbols which arise through a meditation for a woman. And this can be totally unique. And there I think it's no right or wrong, because from this moment of time, we are also co-creators. If somebody is telling us to draw this symbol or to embroider the symbol, then this is right. And I always think this is like with the tradition into the modern times, to bring it alive. Own symbols are more than welcome.
Yeah, so you just said these symbols are also kind of a secret language of the women that lived in the past, and you want to bring this into the present time, or so to use it somehow even for the future. So what is your idea behind that, or what is motivating you to do that?
This is what comes to me. This is what weaving to me, because I remember visiting a shaman in Mongolia with this question, what are my roots? What am I here for? This was my main question on all my travels back then in 2017. And she said to me, this is my sole purpose, what I came here for, to connect with the cultural threads, but weave them into the new. So it's like inviting people to also remember that they are connected to this invisible thread, which is also like the umbilical cord, which is being cut off when we're born, but we are always connected to the web of weird and to the source. And it's just like it happened with me, to connect with your unique destiny thread, and then you start to become a conscious co-creator and weaving the tapestry, which is now, because you're alive now. So it's most important what you bring to the world as a conscious co-creator. Okay. But for me, it happens to also reconnect with my cultural background, because I would have not known how to embroider a Slavic towel or the Kazakh symbolism. I would have not known without the reconnection with my ancestral background.
So what is opening up for women that, for example, come into your workshop and getting tuned into their intuition and start drawing symbols? What is happening with them? What is changing, or what is the outcome? How do they feel different, or what is happening to them?
Well, they start to connect with their own goddess, with her own goddess. Like when I do this Matryoshka co-creative stitching circle, this is very empowering to really feel the goddess in your life, or discovering your main goddess through this, like there is a tool which I learned from this Russian two women, who is your main goddess energy, if you discover that, or also if you discover what is your soul rune. You've got a rune energy and a symbol weaving through us. And once you become more and more conscious about these things which shape us in this physical world, we have got an identity, we have got a personality, we came here for a reason, it's only gaining more conscious about it. So if they gain those tools of more consciousness about why they're here, and they start to weave it and to take it into their own hands, the feeling is of being like a conscious co-creator of own destiny. And it's no longer a mysterious art, but it's a very physical form of expression. It's very powerful, because our hands are also very powerful. They are in the middle, like where our heart is. So what is a lot of times more in like in the realms of the divine, they are like visions. Yeah, and there is the unconscious realm, and we a lot of times, I know it from my life most of the time, before I knew the connection of how to manifest it, it was very elusive. I didn't know what to do with it. It was either very theoretically, or it was totally subconsciously, which overran me, like some traumatic emotions would overrun my life. And I certainly didn't feel like I was consciously creating my life. I was pulled in all different directions. And the hands are in the middle, and they carry like very strong energetic connections as well between the different realms. And once we take it into our hands, it's very powerful. It's like what the women also experience, what I experience as well. It's like becoming those conscious creators, very powerful, because the norms is also feminine energy. We women, we create things. We birth things into existence. That's why out of our wombs come babies. We bring the creation. And it's very powerful if we do that.
Yeah, definitely. What I see is also that in this moment, we're stepping out of this belief that life is happening to us, that we are somehow the victims of the situation, but we can start to create our own future and to manifest really what we want to bring into our life. So this is a totally different view on how we can create life.
Absolutely. And this is, I think, I personally feel that this is what Dalai Lama meant when he said the world will be saved by the Western woman. It's like comes together. It's like this consciousness of the mind, which comes from the Western tradition. It's like, it's also from a lot of Germany, like Goethe and Schiller and everything. It's like a heightened consciousness of the mind, but also with the mysticism from the East. And when we bring it together, then we as women, we birth the new earth. We create it.
Yeah.
And because it's a very feminine energy of giving birth to something new, and in current times everything is crumbling down, all the systems which no longer work are crumbling down. So we as women, we are very fortunate, especially I'm very fortunate nowadays, after I reconnected with my roots, to have been fortunate to be brought up here in the Western world and to have the experience of all different traditions and perspectives and which I would not have had living in the East, to be honest. And to bring those different threads and perspectives and timelines together, brings me a lot of empowerment and conscious power of creation.
Yeah, definitely, yes. So having, of course, the opportunity to live in different cultures, but also seeing things therefore for different perspectives, and now connecting the East and the West, mm-hmm. and bringing out the female side that was so down for many, many, not only years, but decades. So I think this moment is really special. We can see what you said, a lot of systems are totally breaking down, and we can see we can't go forward like this, because there has to be a huge change to create a new life and new world. What is your vision about how should this life look like?
Well, for me, since I consider myself like a new pattern weaver, this is like bringing the new ways of creation. It's also about reconciliation of all those different cultural threads which have been cut off. Because I don't know if you've seen this documentary about, it's called Aluna. It's about the Kogi indigenous people, Native America. It's a beautiful documentary. You can watch it for free for the people who are interested on YouTube. And it touched my soul so much, because it's like looking in the mirror what my calling is. They're walking around the land which has been taken away from them, and they're going around with a golden thread, and they actually thread it back into wholeness. And this is what I've been told by the shaman in Mongolia. She was saying, this is part of what I bring to the world. It's consciously connect with the missing pieces, like which have been cut off. For example, the Silk Road, which has been very wealthy, runs through Almaty, Kazakhstan, where I'm from, through Mongolia, through China, through Pakistan, to India. All these countries have been very wealthy, and if you look at the embroidery, they've got a very, very long tradition of embroidery. So that reminded me as well. It's like, but we forgot it. Yeah, we in the modern world, we forgot it. Like in Kazakhstan, there's hardly anybody anymore doing the embroidery. These are like indigenous women. You have to go and search for them. Very, very difficult to find, and they're dying out quickly. So I was told this is part of my mission, is to reconnect with these cultural roots and to weave them back into the wholeness. And this got a lot to do with reconciliation of culture and the feminine energy and wisdom. And it is an invitation for everywhere around the world. It's like the Native Americans are standing up to reconcile the land. And it's the same everywhere around the world, which has been taken away through war from the people. It's about weaving it back to wholeness and in a very physical way through the thread, like the Kogi people are doing. Going with the thread, true connection with the source, it's like a ritual, it's a ceremony where we weave it back into wholeness. And I think if more and more people are going to do it consciously, it's a very powerful way of reweaving the tapestry and weaving a new tapestry which based on wholeness and belonging, and no longer just cutting the way there and cutting there and taking away the land there. It's like this is not working, and that's why it's breaking together now, which is horrible. I mean, everywhere, the racism, the coronavirus, the recession, this is all the beginning where everything is crumbling, I think.
Yeah, definitely it is. When people are interested to understand more about what you're doing or to connect with you, you said you have books and you do workshops. Can you give a little bit more of details about your books? What are the books? Where can we find them? And about your workshops, do people have to go to Kazakhstan or to Germany? Are you working online? So at these times, this is really interesting to know where people can find you and your books. And can you give more details about that, please?
Well, I've got a website. It's called erikaamazing.me. That's why it's also my surname, Maisie, interwoven in the name. Yeah, so erikaamazing.me. There is a link to my book and also description about the workshops which I'm giving. Since 2 weeks, I'm also starting to offer the Nine Worlds rune readings. Nine Worlds, which are also like the world tree. Yggdrasil has got nine dimensions, or like the Hindus have got Bagua, which has got us in the center, and the eight worlds. So it's a very, very intensive interconnected reading, the Nine Worlds reading, which is also described on the website. If you go to the shop offerings section, people can find out about that. And also online workshops, like to weave like the Matryoshka in a 2 hours workshop. And what is currently like weaving through me, I will develop like a 13-month program where women are invited to really dive deep. Because to weave a dress, to embroider, or like a destined towel like that, this is a real journey, like a very inner journey you go to, and that takes time and commitment. And long term, if coronavirus is going to maybe be more flexible in that with traveling, I also dream to do retreats like in Kazakhstan and in Siberia, maybe also in Mongolia. But my roots are in Kazakhstan, in Siberia, and I know the people there. So to do retreats where I'm most close to my ancestral background.
Okay. Of course, I will type your website, and I don't know, you are also on Facebook and other social media. I will write this in the description of this podcast, so it is easy for everyone to click there and come directly to your website and your workshops. So again, a little bit about the book. So can you tell me, again, it is, you can buy this on normal stores, or is it also on your website, or where do we find this book?
It's on Amazon.
Okay, also
people can purchase this on Amazon. There's a link, direct link to that. And yeah, there's a Kindle version and there's a paperback version in black and white and also in color. In color, I must say, it's double as expensive because it carries a lot of pictures from the embroidery and a lot of pictures which I did on my travels.
Okay.
It's most effective in color. It's like, yeah.
The book you have in front of you, can you show us a little bit of that?
But my version of the book is in black and white. Because these are the author books, which are in black and white. But there I've got like loads of description about the symbolism, like all the different goddess symbolism. And those are in the back, like all this, like pictures from the different museums I visited in Siberia. Yeah, it's like in black and white, it's not that visible. But all the symbols and those different Rushnikis, those are also Rushnikis.
Okay.
They carry a different meaning, all of them. And that's what I find is so interesting. And Kazakh style embroidery is again totally different. And carpets. Most of the time they've got this what looks like a heart. Those are actually Aries horns. This is the Kazakh national flag and the national emblem here. Everywhere you can see this heart symbol, which is actually Aries because it's the most sacred animal in Kazakhstan. Whilst in Siberia, it's the reindeer, it's the meral, because it's much more often around there. So that's where you even go to the cave paintings, and everywhere is this reindeer, and in Kazakhstan, everywhere is the Aries. And that's interesting. And that's why at the moment on my shamanic dress, It's also unfolding. It's happening, like my life is unfolding. For example, I don't have at the moment anything in the bag, so which is coming to me now because I'm also doing a 12-month shamanic education with the shaman with whom I traveled to the sacred mountain Biluka. I'm working very closely now. And in a ritual, what came to me is the snow leopard who lives primarily in the mountains where I'm come from Kazakhstan. And now I hear the calling to embroider the snow leopard and the rune wheel, which just happened a few weeks ago, where I heard the call to do 9 world rune readings. So it's really unfolding, like our life is unfolding. It doesn't stop. And there are always new symbols coming to it. And all the shamans and the costumes that tells a story, or also the drums. Now I hear the call to do my own drum. And it's alive. What we experience, it continues. Like, that's why you sometimes see shamans. They don't even have hardly space on their costumes because they have experienced so much. And I think that's the most important thing to put across if a person decides to commit to go on this journey, either be a drum or this embroidery. It's really a very intimate relationship to the divine sources which are expressing to us, and stay very committed to listen what wants to express to us.
Yeah, this is totally powerful. I can imagine that. Looking back into my life, I had so many steps to do to become what I'm now. And I'm not very good in stitching, but I think I'm good in going to my intuition. And then somehow perhaps I would learn how to do embroidery. So this is very interesting work you're doing. Definitely, yes. And you said perhaps you would like to go back to the more colder countries. I would really love to invite you also to come here to Madeira, into the sunny island, and perhaps you would like to give a retreat here for the people that are in Portugal, and yeah, I would like to invite you to do that.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I would love to do that. I mean, I love the hot countries as well. I was married to a Moroccan guy. So we have got both a son together. So I'm always connected to the hot country of Morocco, which have actually also got a very long tradition of embroidery and textiles. So yeah, I like the hot weather as well. And actually I dream to have a base in Kazakhstan. But where I want to choose how long I stay there, because I'm not a friend to stay totally in the cold all the time, not at all. People say, yeah, but you've been brought up there. It's like, yeah, but I also live here for so long. So it's so nice to have the choice where I feel most happy and joyful from.
Yeah, yeah, so we are creating at the moment a holistic retreat center, a little bit up in the mountains, and I think this would be a perfect spot one day to to show all this to the people here. And I think Madeira also has a long tradition of broidery. I see a lot of old women sitting outside stitching, and so yeah.
Oh, sounds wonderful.
There are some more symbols you will find here on this island. And
I'm sure, because everybody has got their own unique expression. I mean, that always immediately starts to fill me with excitement, like to even observe and learn what they are stitching. Because for me, it's not so much about the technique that every stitch has to be perfect. I was not brought up with that. I only started 3 years ago with stitching. For me, it's really the stories which they tell. The most of the time, it is the older women who still practice that, and they've got fantastic stories to tell and give us the younger generation to pass it on. To the younger generation.
So, yeah.
Well, thank you for the invitation.
Yeah, would be so much fun for me to have you here. Last but not least, do you have some more tips you want to give to the audience that this is kind of takeaway for them?
Yeah, I always love to say, brave to be weird. And begin to weave, and the divine will provide the thread. I'm brave to be weird is with WRD, like my book. It's like not being like strange, but be a conscious weaver and unfold your own myth or story. And just, yeah, begin to weave, and the divine will provide the thread.
Wow. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it that you have been in my show today and giving me and the audience your time. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me and for those great questions and for the space to share. It's always very healing to share. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye. See you. Ciao.
Bye-bye. Blaga Daru in Russian. Many blessings.